PRP is not a quick fix. It's a regenerative process. Our goal is to be approaching surgical outcomes. Therefore, you would not expect to have a painless surgery, just like you would not expect to have injection that is pain-free. Even if you have perfect PRP, you won't get good results if you miss the mark, literally. So get the fundamentals right for your PRP results so they aren't sabotaged so easily by preventable errors. The question is, what are the common mistakes doctors make when starting with platelet-rich plasma? You're using PRP, but are you doing it wrong? From low-dose injections to poor preparation, even the most seasoned surgeons make rookie mistakes. Don't let simple errors ruin your outcomes. I'm Dr. Ariana Demers, the queen of orthobiologics, and I am leading the way in orthopedic surgery innovation, shaping medical practices for success. I'm going to share one of the most frequent errors when beginning PRP therapy, from dosing and preparation to patient instructions. Learn what to avoid so your PRP treatments are given the best chance for success. This is a practical guide for running a tight PRP protocol from day one. Are you using enough platelets? One of the most common mistakes in regenerative medicine is using low-dose PRP. Not all kits are created equal. Many commercial systems yield only 2 or 3 times baseline platelet concentrations, which may fall short of the therapeutic dose. Research suggests that the optimal tissue regeneration typically requires platelet concentrations at least 4 to 5 times at baseline. In fact, recent data in patients with knee osteoarthritis show that injections containing approximately 5 billion platelets in a series of 3 or 10 billion platelets for a single injection were significantly more effective than using only half of that dose. That's a dramatic difference in clinical outcomes. It'd be like using an eighth of a Tylenol and not understanding why you're not having the same outcomes as using a standard Tylenol. It's a dosing effect.
Don't miss out. Please subscribe to our newsletter now to stay ahead of the world of orthobiologics. You can find the link below. Additionally,
if you're ready to start this journey with me in my orthobiologics masterclass, come join us. So how do you avoid underdosing? Number one, always verify the expected platelet yield of your kit that you're using and make sure to draw an adequate volume of blood. Even better, you can measure it with a hemocytometer. Next, be cautious when splitting the final product into multiple syringes or injecting very small volumes. Doing so can reduce the effective dose delivered per site, thus limiting the potential benefit. Your goal should be high concentration platelet delivery precisely to the target tissue. So to properly prepare PRP, you really have to start out with the end in mind. And preparing PRP is a way that we talk about what we want it to do. That means, is it a intra-articular target? Is it a soft tissue target? Are you wanting to keep your lymphocytes and monocytes? Are you looking to have elevated granulocytes, low granulocytes? Do you want super concentrated in the 10 billion realm, or are you looking for a little bit lower dose that has been shown to be beneficial with soft tissue applications like a 5 billion realm? And so there's a lot of ways to go about doing this. Number one is the percent recovery is very important. So the kit that you use, make sure that you know what percent recovery, meaning the available platelets, what percent is the kit actually capturing. Some kits only capture 30% of the available platelets. Some capture 50%. A really nice high quality PRP kit should capture in that 80 to 90% realm. And so if you are using a more low quality kit that has a low recapture rate, you really have to make sure and draw enough blood to make up for that. Additionally, you may want to know the amount of expected red blood cell concentration and how you go about that. There are single spin kits and double spin kits that address those problems differently. And so that's not a one-to-one comparison. And so just make sure that when you're looking at different kits, you understand what the injectate output will be when you're looking at different types of kits. So I think the most important part is really knowing what your output is, meaning what your final platelet count or dose, or at least at a minimum percent recovery, starting platelet count, and concentration fold increase. If you're not measuring those things, we really won't be able to clearly know and track what the injectate was. So it's really hard to then tie that to the clinical outcome that you're seeing. So the question is, now that you have a great platelet-rich plasma injectate that you've created, are you targeting the problem? Even if you have perfect PRP, you won't get good results if you miss the mark, literally. If you are using diagnostic imaging to identify the site or the pain generator, and with guidance to guide your injections to exactly the right location, then you're doing yourself and your patient a great service. Blind injections risk missing the damaged tissue entirely, especially the tendon tears or small joint targets. You could even end up injecting into healthy tissue, or worse yet, into the synovium, which can cause significant pain and swelling. Even brief ultrasound exam before the procedure can absolutely improve your accuracy and the confidence. Now, if you have the ultrasound, use the ultrasound for the exam and for the ultrasound-guided injection. Finally, timing is important too. Please avoid giving PRP injections directly after high-dose steroid injections or other medical issues that are contraindications for these regenerative therapies. So the final piece is, we do advise discontinuation of the majority of the anti-inflammatories several days before and after the injection, because common medications like ibuprofen can interfere with platelet function and compromise that treatment response. A lot of my colleagues are unclear on what to tell their patients after PRP injections. So my question is, are they managing the patient expectations and follow-up appropriately? So I think one of the key mistakes is over-promising results or not warning the patient that they may have some inflammation in that first 48 to 72 hours. PRP is not a quick fix. It's a regenerative process. I was just talking to a colleague today about the fact that, you know, some of these higher concentration platelet-rich plasma, especially if they have higher lymphocytes and monocytes, can cause a little bit of a flare. So it doesn't act the same as getting a steroid injection, right? But what I was telling him is, I tell my patients, listen, you're going to be pretty sore for the first 48 to 72 hours. Our goal is to be approaching surgical outcomes. Therefore, you would not expect to have a painless surgery, just like you would not expect to have an injection that is pain-free. Those are our old expectations. And I think we just need to do a really nice job of giving those patients the expectations ahead of time. For example, clinical data from Johns Hopkins shows that PRP has a joint pain that tends to peak even up to 1 week after injections. So plan ahead for that post-injection care, which can often include a short period of relative rest, guided physical therapy, Tylenol. You know, these patients should expect mild to moderate post-injection soreness, some downtime, and that this is normal and not a failure. And then the next piece is scheduling a follow-up visit within 48 weeks to assess the progress. I have an 8-week follow-up where I see my patients, and at that time, I tell them that this is still very early, and I only expect about a 50% improvement at the 8-week mark. And so if they come in and they have 50% improvement at 8 weeks, I tell them they're on trajectory and we expect continued improvement over the next 4 to 6 months. Finally, make sure you document the pre-injection patient-reported outcomes, pain levels, and disability, because this is such a slow onset injection that the patients forget how they were feeling so long ago. And so if you have clear documentation of pain level, disability, what they can and cannot do before, and then when you come back at 8 weeks and you go through that again, they're like, you know what, doc? You are right. I am better. That is good. That really helps to encourage the patient that they're doing well, that they're on target, on trajectory for a more comprehensive long-term result. And when patients are paying out of pocket, really, that's very important because they do want to get better. They've had an investment in their health and they just want to ensure that this is going the right way and it improves your trust and transparency. So avoid the classic newbie traps. Use high platelet dosing. Draw sufficient blood and use proper centrifugation techniques. Inject exactly where the pathology is. And I would recommend highly using ultrasound guided injections. And then coach patients about the right preparation and outcome expectations, avoiding anti-inflammatories, when to expect improvement, when to expect pain. So get the fundamentals right for your PRP results so they aren't sabotaged so easily by preventable errors. For more clinical insights and practical tips on PRP and orthobiologics, subscribe to the newsletter below. Stay ahead in integrating new therapies into your practice today.